All right. Good morning, everybody. Well, first of all, thank you very much for attending. I know it's early morning, but we appreciate, and here at the city, we're happy to host you right today. And we look forward for a great conversation today. So thank you again for coming. This is a roundtable discussion, one out of six that the roadmap team has been carrying out. And we did this roundtable discussion along in collaboration with the Office of Sustainability and Resilience. So this is one out of six roundtable discussions happening under the roadmap for inclusive innovation. And this is a strategic plan launched by Mayor Peduto and our previous Chief Innovation Officer, Deborah Lam, in 2014. And we looked at other cities for inspiration in terms of, you know, how to best place this strategic plan. And one of the things that we noticed at the beginning was that a lot of other cities, national, international, did not have the inclusivity lens within their plan. So we wanted to be different. So we included inclusivity as part of our roadmap for inclusive innovation strategic plan. And just as the mayor summarizes in her smart city application, if it's not for all, it's not for us. And so in 2014, the mayor carried five different roundtable discussions. And after that, he gave information to come up with the roadmap for inclusive innovation. And it's broken down into six different focus areas with 20 different goals and over 100 actions. And we work along with partners, for example, with the Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh and with the county and with several organizations, for-profit and non-profit organizations in the city. But today we're exclusively focusing on the green technology sector and how to advance it, and which goal is to make Pittsburgh become a leader in sustainable and sustainable and clean technology. And so what has happened for over the past 2 years? So we are excited that we have engaged 61 partner organizations to work with us in the roadmap. And also due to this, we have carried over 60 innovation events, including Inclusive Innovation Week that my colleague Christine talked about. And also we implemented the first startup program here at the city, PGH Lab, that brings startup companies here into the city and to test products and services and help us make the city work more efficiently. This year we are we implemented the first pilot program last year, and we're now launching our second cycle, and we're open to applications, and applications are due on March 6th. So the roadmap is this is a strategic plan where Pittsburgh wants to implement to become a hub for technology and innovation. And today, Grant is going to state the goals and focus that we are going to be, that we want to get gain from you and in this productive conversation coming up. So thank you, Grant. Okay, let's see. All right, sorry about that.
Thank you, Anna. I appreciate it. As I said, my name is Grant Irvin. I serve as the Chief Resilience Officer. And one of the big key things I'd like to do is first thank you all for being here. A lot of familiar faces that we've engaged over the last few months and years in several of our planning activities, both with the creation of the city's first resilience plan, but also with the development of the city's climate action plan. And your partnership is really key to us because effectively what we're creating is a very logical approach to how we can access existing assets in the region to help us deliver the overall objectives for the city of Pittsburgh with regards to climate and energy. And one of the things I wanted to do today to help kind of set the stage for everyone is really help us focus what our conversation is going to be about today. So in prior conversations with regards to the innovation roadmap, we've really focused on the issues of energy efficiency. So for example, through our PGH Labs programs, we've focused on technologies that we're using inside of our buildings right now. So things that are looking at conserving energy in city facilities, how we're better able to manage energy consumption in our fleet, and really looking at the startup ecosystem and how they play a role in introducing those technologies in our municipal service platform. Today, we really want to focus on energy generation and how that energy generation can be local. So you hear a lot of conversation about buy local in terms of food or eat local with your local restaurants. One of the things we really want to think about today is how we buy local in terms of renewable energy here in the Pittsburgh region. So over the course of the last year, through our climate action planning efforts, we've been able to identify a host of potential assets that you all represent here in the room that can be potential generators of renewable energy. The thing, and I was telling Jennifer Wilhelm about this earlier this morning, is that a lot of this technology that we're going to talk about at our tables here today isn't necessarily new or innovative. But what needs to be new and innovative is the process and the practice in which we access that energy generation capabilities. So what I want to do personally is talk a little bit about the work that we do and how we currently purchase and procure energy here in the city and some of the strategies that we've deployed over the last 4 or 5 years in terms of procurement strategies. But then I also want to tee up the three next presentations that you're going to see, which are really going to focus on the issues of scale and access, and then kind of pivot us towards a conversation about technology that's available and the tactics that we might deploy in order to access that type of technology. So real quickly, in terms of what we currently operate now within the city of Pittsburgh, we have what's called the Western Pennsylvania Energy Consortium. The WPEC is a collaborative venture of the city of Pittsburgh and about 30-plus organizations that created an aggregated purchasing platform. So organizations like the Pittsburgh Zoo and Aquarium, Allegheny County, Pittsburgh Water and Sewer Authority all come together in a biannual meeting to purchase electricity through what's called a reverse energy auction. And that reverse energy auction has enabled us to do two things. One, it's been able us to help reduce costs. So the participants in the consortium see a cost savings because of the aggregated buying power that they collectively bring together. But the other key thing that's important for this conversation is that we've been able to introduce renewables into our energy portfolio. And those renewables have increased by 5% each purchasing practice that we get involved with. So currently, we're looking to do our next energy purchase in April, and that will take us up to about 35% of our entire portfolio will be renewable energy. And that is procured through what are called RECs. And those RECs are non-certified RECs, meaning that that renewable energy purchase can come from anywhere in the country. So it can be from a Kansas wind farm or hydropower in Texas, but it's pulled together by the winning aggregate of the purchasing platform. Now, one of the things that we've set forth, and Sarah will talk a little bit, Sarah Yeager from our team will talk about this in a little bit, is that through the mayor's leadership, we have set a goal of 100% renewable electricity purchase by the year 2030. So part of today's conversation is to start to figure out, how do we get there? How do we go from 35% to 100%? And also, the other thing I would throw into that conversation is, how do we enable local renewable energy technologies to be a part of that platform? So with regards to that, the other piece of the conversation, I think, with regards to the energy consortium that we want to think about is, how do we increase the scale? So as the energy consortium has grown from originally 5 members, I said it's up to about 30 now, how do we continue to add benefit to other smaller local governments, other nonprofits, hospitals, universities, et cetera? So let's give some thought to with regards to how do we pull together and increase our buying power here in Pittsburgh. With regards to scale, the three subsequent presentations that you're going to see are going to touch upon the citywide perspective, where Sarah's going to talk a little bit about what we're looking at with regards to climate action planning within the city of Pittsburgh and the region. Steve Miller from Mondre Energy is going to talk about a really great, exciting conversation that we're having as part of the Eco Innovation District in Uptown and the western edge of Oakland, and really thinking about the district scale. So how can we operate energy at a district level, both in terms of deployment, generation, and the aggregated benefit for community residents as well as institutional providers within that district? And then Rebecca Kiernan from our team is going to talk about some really great work that she's been doing in partnership with Duquesne Light and the German Marshall Fund. So looking at how community or community benefits can be accelerated and accessed through energy purchasing at the community level. So thinking about programs such as community grade solar, et cetera. So really thinking about the different ways that we pull that all together. So finally, I'll just leave you with these two thoughts in terms of the table conversations that we're really interested in. Is one is thinking about what the technology is available locally and how we might look to pursue greener or more renewable generation here in the Pittsburgh region. And then secondly, what are the tactics that might be used by local community leaders, local government, and the private sector? What are those partnership opportunities that we can pull together to help access that renewable energy that we know that is available? Okay, so with that, I'll turn it over to Steve, Sarah, come on down. So you're the next speaker on the Innovation Roundtable today. So thanks very much, and we look forward to the conversation.
Thank you. As Grant mentioned, I am the resilience analyst here with the City of Pittsburgh. The majority of my time is spent working on the third version of the City of Pittsburgh's Climate Action Plan. So that also includes compiling the greenhouse gas inventory for the City of Pittsburgh. We are currently working to clean up some of 2013's data. And what we're finding from that data is that about 56% of our greenhouse gas emissions are due to the use of electricity. So as Grant mentioned, a lot of our efforts in the past have been energy efficiency, reducing the consumption of energy, which I'm gonna talk about a couple projects that we've done here within the sixth floor and within the city to realize some of those savings. But we also are looking at moving more towards renewable energies. So within the Climate Action Plan, we have the 2030 goals, which the mayor set out, one of which is the 100% renewable by 2030. And then we also have objectives and actions within that. One of our actions or one of our objectives is to not only use more renewables, but also to produce more locally. So I believe the number is 200 megawatts. So we are looking to install 200 megawatts of renewable energy within the local area so that we can not only use as Grant mentioned, buying renewables from across the country, but actually have that industry here and have those job opportunities locally as well. So going back a little bit, some of the other projects that I mentioned within the city county building that we've been working on, some of the ones in the past that Anya wanted me to touch on, as far as the energy savings and energy efficiency, we've been partnering with CMU and the Metro 21 department to create an energy dashboard. If you have been on the sixth floor before and gone through to the front desk, it's located there. Our first actual visible dashboard is located above the desk there. And we have been working with Azizan and his team at the university to do monitoring of the energy use on this floor. So it kind of goes back to the, you can't manage what you can't measure. So by being able to better measure the use of electricity across this floor, we can then find where we're using excess and how we can actually reduce that energy. So we have the Metro 21 dashboard, which includes energy use from HVAC systems, plug loads, and the lighting across this floor. And with that data, we're getting to the point where we can create reductions. So we have worked with a few different pilot companies and other companies that are locally based in Pittsburgh to try and see some of these savings. One is Boss Control. They do plug load monitoring. So they can actually install monitors at the individual workstation, printers, refrigerators, so we can actually track how much electricity is being used by individual devices. This helps us gather data when purchasing is coming up. If somebody requests a new computer, we can see maybe we can get them something that's more efficient. We know that their old computer is using a lot of energy. With the Boss Control devices, we're also able to control the energy, so we can set things on a timer. Nobody is here in the middle of the night, so why are all of our computers still on? The Boss Control devices allow for a schedule to be set, so every day at 11 p.m. that computers are turned off, but then they're automatically turned back on at 6 o'clock the next morning so that they're ready to go when people arrive in the morning. So that's one project based on the plug load level that we're working with. We are also working with Height, another local lighting company, to do a retrofit of the sixth floor lighting, similar with the computers that are left on. The lights on this floor stay on at all times. So we're looking at how we can reduce a large amount of that peak energy that we're seeing on our dashboard, simply by having more efficient lights, but also having the capacity to turn the lights off when nobody is here. We also recently started a project with Panoramic Power. They're helping us to get better sensors within this floor. So the current sensors that we have for the electric loads, we have to replace the batteries every 3 months, which is fairly inefficient. So they're helping us to install monitors that can tie directly into the electricity itself so that they're more sustainable and don't need that constant update of batteries. And with that data, we're able to get more sustainable data as well as more accurate, because we don't have the kind of blackouts of data that we were having with the old sensors when the batteries would die. So those are a few of the projects that we've worked on in the past that were part of the roadmap in the past, and some of the successes we've seen as part of the energy efficiency portion. And again, we're looking at how we can expand that into some of the renewables as well.
Good morning. I'm Steve Miller, Vice President of Engineering with Mondre Energy in Philadelphia. Mondre Energy is an energy consulting firm. Our services are procurement advisory services for large electricity and natural gas consumers. We have an advisory service for building owners who are interested in investing in energy efficiency and on-site power generation. We also have a policy support group that deals with energy efficiency programs that utilities sponsor. We do evaluation work for utilities on the ground in Pennsylvania and other states. Our firm's founder, Judith Mondre, is here sitting at the first table. But today, I'd like to talk about some of the work we've been doing here for the city of Pittsburgh on the district energy system for Uptown. This particular system is part of the Eco Innovation District project. Our firm is one of about seven consultants that have been retained to come up with a executable plan for the Uptown area that is green, improves the quality of life. And in our case, the idea behind the district energy system was to provide a affordable, low-cost, and resilient energy infrastructure for the residents and businesses and institutions in Uptown. The themes that I'd like to emphasize in this development work are really, really three. On the affordability front, well, let's back up and say that the whole planning process here for the district energy system involves balancing, as Grant was saying, certain known and proven technologies so that they provide the benefits that I've just mentioned. Some power sources, as you know, are affordable, but they're not as clean as they could be. For example, grid power that's supplied from the PJM, it comes from a mix of fossil fuel plants, primarily coal, some natural gas, and other fossil fuels. So it's affordable, but it's not as clean as it could be. On the clean side, we have renewable energy, you know, solar, wind, biogas projects that are clean, but they aren't particularly affordable sometimes based on the cost of installing these plants, and what really drives the cost for these facilities is how much the capacity is utilized. For example, solar, if you installed 10 kilowatts of solar, you're only going to get about 14% capacity utilization out of it, so it's extremely clean, but the affordability is a little bit out of the range for what our purposes were. On the resiliency side, we've sort of landed in the position that resiliency primarily is a function of having local supply and a secure distribution route to get the power from where it's being generated to where you are. So it's really not, we didn't think it was possible to have a discussion about resiliency, another level of resiliency above what's provided now, without having a discussion about microgrids. The microgrid is a local purpose-built electrical distribution system that delivers electricity from a local source to local end users. So in developing this plan, we had to acknowledge that there are certain regulatory issues around establishing a microgrid. But we would hope to address those in such a way that a microgrid could be established in Uptown that meets all of the regulatory requirements and does not interfere with the local utilities' franchise rights. So this entire exercise was a balancing exercise, a portfolio building exercise, where you try and take, mix and match all these various elements to come up with a plan that works. And based on our experience in evaluating such things for other clients, we have a sense for how the numbers work in these situations, and there is an appropriate mix of solar, natural gas-fired cogeneration, and renewables that seem to make sense for Uptown. Now, the biggest component of this, as far as energy supply, is going to be the combined heat and power system, which we probably should talk about for a second. Combined heat and power is a fossil fuel technology, but among the fossil fuel technologies that are out there, it is the lowest emission source that's currently available with current technologies. And essentially, what it is that you're using a single fossil fuel, natural gas, to make two products, heat and power, simultaneously. As opposed to central power plants that only make one of those products. You know, a large central power plant that's used in the PJM, only about 30% of the fuel energy content in the fuel is used for electricity. The remaining 70% or so is rejected into the atmosphere and is not particularly usable. What cogeneration does, the way that we think about it sometimes, is that if you take a large power plant, a conventional power plant that's fueled by natural gas, and you whack it up into 1,000 parts, and you take those parts and you put them in the community where you expect to use the electricity, you now have enough waste heat in small enough packets that you can actually utilize locally. So the idea behind combined heat and power is really a variant, and we think it's an evolution of central power plants to a configuration and a mode that's useful for local energy consumers. So the natural gas cogeneration power source in our plan will provide roughly 65% of the electricity that we would consume in this conceptual plan for Uptown. The carbon emissions from a CHP plant are roughly 60% lower than grid-supplied power. So you can see how you can establish a mix of affordable and clean versus grid power that happens to be extremely expensive during off-peak hours, extremely inexpensive during off-peak hours, that we could also use in this mix. So the combination of combined heat and power, solar power, battery storage should be mentioned. We've kind of conceptualized the use of batteries a little bit differently than what is typically discussed, which is solar power and batteries. And batteries are being used to time shift the production of electricity to other hours of the day. In a microgrid scenario where you have multiple generation sources that I've just discussed, the usefulness of batteries kind of expands a little bit. It not only allows you to use solar power at hours when it's more useful, it also allows you to take extremely inexpensive off-peak power and use it during periods of time when you otherwise couldn't access it. So we think the value of battery power in a microgrid, multiple power source scenario is a bit higher than it is in a solar-only scenario. It ultimately results in some avoided capacity investment in CHP that you can value and impute into the value of what you're willing to pay for batteries. So we think that's a little bit of a different approach, and I think we rely on that actually in order to balance the emissions and affordability piece. So if you did a pie chart, and you tried to say, okay, what's the mix of energy sources here for Uptown, it would be, you know, roughly 75% combined heat and power, maybe 10% renewables, and the rest of it is going to be extremely inexpensive off-peak power from PJM. That there are times of year when the price of power is actually close to zero, And when you have that source of inexpensive power out there, you have to include it in the portfolio in order to make the numbers come out. We can't envision a scenario where you don't utilize that. But I think the key here is that between those sources of generation, the batteries being used to balance, and the microgrid being in place to provide resiliency, there is a plausible scenario where all these things can be balanced. And I guess on the executability perspective, what we mean by that is that we don't want to have any technologies in the mix here that carry with them any unusual amounts of technical risk. We think that when public-private partnerships are involved, the equity investor component of the financing is extremely interested in getting their money back, and we want to make sure that the technical risk is put to bed. So proven technologies are included in the scope. We think we'd be able to provide a reasonable rate of return for infrastructure projects these days, as people would expect. But I think the other interesting role that we would contemplate here for investors on the renewable side has to do with the solar and the battery piece. We thought about the fact that solar renewable is really the only technology out there where once you've invested in the asset, there really isn't any variable expense associated with the power that comes out of it. It's essentially cost-free for about 15, 20 years. And we thought that the best home for that sort of attribute could be in power supply for the low-income population. And why do we say that? That's because that a party or an entity that was interested or whose duty it was to support programs for the low-income community could conceivably invest in such a system, say in Uptown, and be able to provide electricity to low-income residents there at what we think would be a lower cost than subsidy programs that utilities currently implement. The societal cost would be directionally lower, and certain costs for low-income programs don't get socialized. But I think it lines up fairly nicely with what we think the role of certain philanthropic organizations are, particularly in Pittsburgh. And we think that there's an important role for them in being a co-investor in some of the assets that we're talking about. So the bottom line here is that the technology is ready, that there's some regulatory clarity involved or needed for actually implementing a workable microgrid, but we think a lot of those issues are addressable. Duquesne Light has been a very constructive partner in developing plans for Uptown, and we think we do see a path forward to having something implementable here in Pittsburgh that addresses all the criteria that we earlier talked about. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
Morning. I'm Rebecca Kiernan. I'm the Senior Resilience Coordinator at the City, and I'm here to talk about a project that Ben Morris from Duquesne Light and I are working on in partnership with the German Marshall Fund of the United States. They're running a Dialogues for Change program, which is an exchange program with three U.S. cities and then three German cities. So we've met twice already. It's a series of four times. We got to go to Germany, and we talk about positive community development strategies and share some cross-pond experiences, which is pretty neat. So the purpose of our project is to try to figure out how to satisfy the city's goal of 100% renewable energy by 2030. That's currently only slated for the city's facilities. So we have been asking, we've basically come up with a big list of questions thus far. So we're trying to figure out how do we reach that goal and what does that goal actually mean? So there's a couple of ways that we could go about satisfying that 100% specification. So we could either purchase or we could generate. And if we purchase, what are the priorities for the city to purchase? Is it local purchase? Is it any renewable purchase? Would we, prioritize, some sort of like a local production here? And then on the generation side, would we install on our own facilities? Or would we contract it out? So based on that, we're also trying to figure out how do we fit that into a community benefit as well. So we've identified some potentials for leveraging, the first and most obvious is the Polar program. So that's the provider of last resort that Duquesne Light is working on. So that's 10% makeup of that needs to be renewable energy. And the provider of last resort, I assume everybody kind of knows what that is, but that's if you don't choose who your energy generator is, then you get the default from Duquesne Light. So 10% of that makeup needs to then be 10% is what Duquesne Light is aiming for. So how do we fit in some of our own renewable targets in our facilities with that Polar program? So that's how that partnership came about. So a couple of other things that we've looked at leveraging, is there a possibility to work with the Western PA Energy Consortium, which you heard about a little bit earlier? So they currently purchase 30% of renewable energy, and that's the, consortium of energy purchasers. So could that be increased to 100% at some point? Is there a possibility for that, or do we need to start thinking about our own routes and how to supplement that to reach the city's target? There's also the Eco Innovation District work that we just heard about, is there a way to make that model in Uptown more scalable to the rest of the city? There's also some interesting community solar projects that are kind of skating some of the regulations and looking at if there's grant funding to install solar on top of a building, could you then use the savings for community projects? So we've been looking at that model as well. And then this is all kind of contingent on our facilities optimization study. So that's the city is looking at all of our facilities, which is 100 and something buildings, and trying to figure out which ones need to be kept, which ones need to be sold, and which ones need to be demoed. So based on that, when that finally comes out, we would then engage in like a roof mapping exercise to figure out how much generation we could actually have. And then also we've also looked into, our clean tech sector. So, there's obviously work in waste to energy and wind and solar, and then also in hydro in the region. So how could we leverage some of that to meet our targets? So currently we're developing a matrix to figure out the benefits and the challenges in purchase versus generation. There's that local versus purchasing RECs question versus, installing on our own facilities. And then there's the whole puzzle piece of how do we extend all of those benefits into the communities and satisfy the Polar RECs. So that's kind of the questions that we're dealing with right now. And then we had developed a little icon that tried to map out like who would actually, if we were to install the generation or aggregate the generation, like who would own, operate, or pay for some of those renewable generations. So I'll show you the icon some other time, but that's what we're working on right now. Thanks.
Okay. So thanks, everyone. Rebecca actually did an awesome job there of kind of pulling all together with the key questions that we're asking. So just as we kind of set up into the tabletop exercise here, to set that up for a second, is that each table will have a facilitator and a note taker that will be able to capture kind of the thoughts and conversations. Just in addition to kind of the questions that Rebecca posed to everyone, a couple of just some reflections on what you heard here, maybe to kick off your conversations, is that we have key assets already in place here in the region in terms of either things that exist on the ground at the district level or within the city, in terms of things like locks and dams, land, facilities, parking lots and garages, wastewater treatment facilities, the Duquesne Light Polar Program. So there's a lot of architecture that's already available for us. The exercise at the tabletop is really to figure out how do we start to stitch it all together, right? So thinking about some of the cogent strategies that we might be able to deploy in order to help enable some of these opportunities to be realized. So with that, thanks to our presenters. we'll turn it over to our tabletop facilitator. So if you're a facilitator, if you can just raise your hand, and then note takers, if you can parachute in and deploy yourself at each table, we'll start to capture the conversation. So thank you very much.
So it seems like everybody had great conversations and we want to hear about them. So if can someone, one person from your table come up here and tell us a little bit, a small recap of what you talked about and, you know, main ideas and that you will want to share with the rest of the group, please. Okay. So, or yeah.
I guess I got elected. We're not gonna share the baton here. So a couple things that we organized our conversation into, which you see here is a beautiful montage of Sharpie art. So what we came up with is a couple ways to look at this. One is in terms of organizing our technology and existing assets, and then we thought a little bit in terms of tactics. So I'll just kind of go briefly over this. In terms of the technology and assets, we thought of a lot of the physical manifestations as well as some of the ecosystems that are existing. So existing ecosystems, we thought in terms of our clean energy ecosystem, so companies and firms that are already working here in Pittsburgh, both in terms of some of our startup firms, but also kind of long-standing Pittsburgh brand companies that are working in this space. We also thought in terms of the advanced manufacturing ecosystem, so really thinking in terms of how manufacturing processes here that are being designed and deployed in Pittsburgh fit into the clean energy sector and vice versa. So how can we leverage clean energy both in terms of consumption, but also in terms of manufacturing the tools of clean energy here in Pittsburgh. Some of the physical assets that we thought through were things like our lock and dam systems, land for solar generation, particularly things like brownfields, also facilities, so both existing municipal facilities, private facilities and commercial space in the 2030 districts in Oakland and in downtown, but also the looking strategically at the universities and hospitals of key places that we could focus in on. We also thought a lot about parking lots and garages as key places where solar has a key opportunity, local wind generation capabilities, both in terms of micro turbines, but also regional assets like Laurel Ridge that provide big opportunities for us. And then also kind of our existing steam facilities and some of our natural gas assets, whether that's in terms of things like fuel cells or also looking at kind of new manufacturing capabilities that might be generated from natural gas assets that could couple with some of our renewable assets. And then we shifted to tactics, so things that we might look to match some of those assets with tactics, so tools like power purchase agreements or PPAs. We had a lot of conversations about biodigestion and how we could use kind of waste to energy as a resource for us, both in terms of biomass, but also in terms of wastewater treatment facilities. We also talked about building codes and just codes in general. So what are some of the things that the city could use in order to help enable some of these technologies, also things like tech enablers like Wi-Fi access that help allow us to deploy new types of technologies. Finally, we thought a lot about leveraging buying power, both with kind of the municipal government, but also our university partners, and how we might be able to leverage buying power to help enable some of these technologies, and how that has geographic benefits and connections to it as well that benefit our communities. Great, thank you.
All right, how about my table?
We were all over the board, so let's see if I can wrap this up.
Let's see. So this is for the camera, actually. It doesn't have, it doesn't work.
Okay. All right, so my team, if there are other things I missed, please fill in. So I think, similar to this group, we talked about a whole host of sort of specific opportunities that exist. But when it came down to sort of being asked, what are the next steps? How do we get from point A to point B? I think the big thing that came out of it was we could spend our time on hundreds of different things. However, and I think a lot of folks tend to do that because there's so much good work. However, the city has to prioritize some projects, some opportunities based on sort of a range of different opportunities. One, the most greenhouse gas reduction opportunity. Resilience is obviously a key point. Economic development and job creation, as well as community benefits. So in my brain, as I'm trying to look through all of these things, we're trying to sort of think like, okay, what kind of projects can we establish, pick, that sort of begin checking off multiple of those opportunities? And I think there are a host of different ways to do this, and it's up to the city and stakeholders to sort of prioritize that. And other pieces that we identified that are key in that are the financing opportunities, you know, how do we get businesses to be playing an active role? And if that some of those questions haven't been asked when it comes to whether it's efficiency or renewable energy, figuring out what are the barriers to these companies, these bigger companies where you see major gains and changes coming to the table to have these conversations. So, I mean, so overall, we just sort of looked at how these different opportunities from biodigestion to city level solar to upgrading existing CHP impact facilities will drive these goals of greenhouse gas emissions, resiliency improvement, economic development, jobs, community benefits. So sort of trying to layer many of those things on whatever priority projects are selected will enable the city to get the most bang for their buck and I think really see a transformational change, not only as we're trying to fight climate change, but if you can connect renewable technologies to the opportunities for jobs and economic development, that's when you, in my opinion, and this is now I'm stating my opinion, you really get to the average working American to then be also fighting for these changes. If you can connect it to their everyday life, that's when we start winning on climate, in my opinion. And I think a lot of these things, Pittsburgh has just huge opportunities to really be doing that here in the city. Team, there were many specifics, but feel free to, if there's anything else I'm missing, Major? Okay, thanks. Table?
That table?
This guy? No, you got suckered into this thing.
So we boiled it down to finance. Feel free to jump in case I miss anything. But we really had a conversation about like access to capital. So a lot of the people who are, you know, developing some of these projects, and we have a lot of them, you know, within the city, we have a lot of opportunity, but that access to capital is really important. So we also talked about how, you know, how do you access that capital? Well, through long-term contracts. So if the city or, you know, the PA Energy Consortium or something of that nature increasing, we talked also about, you know, starting with some corporate entities as well to kind of increase that load. So, you know, how can we enter into some long-term contracts to really make that viable? In thinking about long-term contracts too, like we have a tendency to, you know, want to jump into that when the oil prices are higher, and right now they're low, but I guess right now is the time that we should be, you know, setting some of those price points, like now is the opportunity. What was the other thing? Thinking about pricing also, that's where you get the benefit for the residents too. That's how it connects to the community. So lower energy prices is better for the community. And then we also talked about a potential like cooperative model and how funding is really low from the USDN for the rural utility services. And if something like the PA Energy Consortium could, you know, be formulated into a co-op, you know, that would really help out some of our local generators. I miss anything? Okay.
Good.
And just to let you know, we'll be compiling all of the ideas, and we'll be sending a report to you. And any feedback that we could get will be greatly appreciated. Thank you. And last table,
thanks. So our group talked about some kind of high-level aspects that can either encourage or are current barriers to new renewable energies in the area. and the kind of the expansion of renewables. One of the things that we discussed, one of the key points that came up a lot was kind of determining what the city capacity is. So what is the city willing to put in place money-wise, time-wise, actual infrastructure as far as increasing renewables? What are kind of like the lines or the triggers directly within the city operations? And part of that was kind of showing that leading by example and also initiative, this is what the city is going to do, this is what we're committed to, this is how much money we're going to spend, and then hoping that others and encouraging others to kind of get in line with those specific goals. So really clarifying that and making that publicly known. We also discussed with some of the industries as they're looking to come into Pittsburgh or into the area, one of the big factors they look for is kind of the uncertainty within the market or security within the market. If new companies are looking to come to Pittsburgh, create new, we talked about the waste to energy plants, solar arrays, whatever it may be, they really need that security to make it beneficial for them and something that's gonna work out in the long run. One of the key pieces we talked about that was kind of the long-term leasing ability, make sure that they know they'll have that land. And then some of the also connections with the utilities, net metering, and really signing on to those agreements. With that, we also discussed kind of finding ways to project risk and make sure that it's known ahead of time, like what might be both internally within the city, but also for individual companies, what might some of the risks be? How can we avoid some of those? I'm trying to think if were there any other. It also there another going back to our first kind of with the city capacity. We also discussed the need to determine whether the city wants to actually own and generate renewable energies internally, or how that's structured between the purchasing. The idea has been thrown around of creating a renewable energy authority or some kind of outside entity to manage that, because as we do increase local renewables, there's going to be need to be management of that. Are there any other key? I think those were kind of the high-level key pieces that we touched on.
All right, so thank you. So with that in mind, thank you so much for coming. Again, we had a great discussion, and I look forward to getting any feedback, from this kind of sessions, and just look forward to, just check in with us, and we will send that report as soon as we can. And if you are curious about how our presentation looked like today, we have printouts of the PowerPoint for you to take if you would like to take them with you on your way out. Thank you so much, and have a good day. Thank you.